Okay.
Do you want the water there? Yeah, and then we'll start. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, now we're... Okay. Okay, there we go, and we'll pick back up with when you're growing up in Atlanta and what schools you went to. And
okay, well, I went to Highland School, Grammar School, which is still there. It's now a condominium. It's on North Avenue and near Highland. And then I went to Bass Junior High, and my sister, who was a brilliant scholar, preceded me, and they expected the same out of me, and I was mainly interested in baseball and building model airplanes, and I didn't do very well, so my father decided to take me out and put me in Marist, and there was only one lead teacher there at the time, Professor McEwen, who had a great Irish brogue, and one thing I remember the interview was, he said, "Not to worry, Mr. Alexander. If we can't teach him, we'll learn him." So I had two fine years there, and it was right in the middle of the Depression, and my sister was at Wellesley, and my father couldn't afford keeping her at Wellesley and me at Marist, and I went to Boys High, which was a good school, but from being a more or less big shot on a small campus, I didn't know anybody, and it wasn't a great experience. I went from there to Georgia Tech for 1 year, and then I transferred to Yale, and I graduated in 1940, which was just before the war. In fact, that summer of 1940 was when France fell. And then I had an AB there, a major in architecture, and I went from there to MIT to get an advanced degree. And while I was there, I was invited to have dinner one night with some, I've forgotten who they were, a couple in New York. And there were a couple who had just escaped from Germany. And when I heard, they told them about just what was going on. And in fact, I'm Jewish, certainly had an influence on me, but I decided I wasn't interested in school anymore. I wanted to get in the war. Well, I'd been taking this course that Roosevelt had set up, civilian pilot training, which he knew for the war that was coming, he was going to need a lot of pilots. And I started at Roosevelt Field on Long Island, which was the field that Lindbergh took off when he crossed the ocean in 1927. And I went on with that when I was at MIT. And I ended up with a commercial pilot's license. On the way home from MIT, I stopped at the Royal Canadian Air Force recruiting office, which was at LaGuardia. And when these recruiters discovered I was a Yale graduate, 1 year at MIT, and had a commercial pilot's license, one of these guys literally stood in front of the door and said, "You're not leaving until you sign up." I said, "Oh yes, I am." And I went home and I joined the Navy. And I started what they called the elimination base, was here in Atlanta. And that was in order to eliminate you. But I got through it all right. I had to learn the Navy way, but I was very much at home in it, and the I had a instructor that I liked very much. He was a Marine named Walcott. I think he had a lot to do with me later transferring into the Marines. He after the war, he became a landscape architect. But the I was out there in training on December the 7th, and there was a man, Frank Neely, who was married to a cousin of mine. Frank was a very prominent citizen. He was CEO of Riches and head of the Federal Reserve Bank and the nuclear, whatever, activator at Georgia Tech, his name for him, the Neely reactor. And I was out there with this date who had the great name of Newts Crenshaw. And we, after dinner, she and I were in the living room, and the Neelys had excused themselves to take a nap. Well, Frank came out and he said, you better listen to the radio. And they were announcing the attack on Pearl Harbor. And I said, I don't want to hear anymore, because the next thing they're going to say is all military personnel report to their bases. Well, when I did report, they had the place surrounded by Marine guards. And the guys that were out cheating without the passes, they were sentenced to stay on the base until they went to the next step, which would have been Pensacola, Jacksonville, Corpus Christi. Fortunately, I had mine. So, but you would have thought the Japanese were about to come up to Chattahoochee the way the base reacted. And they stationed us around the perimeter with Springfield. And I was on Cheshire Bridge Road behind a chain link fence. And my order was to yell at any car after 11 o'clock to halt. And if they didn't halt, I was to fire in the air. And if that didn't stop them, I was supposed to hit the tires through a chain link fence. Come on. So I was out there and I saw this car coming. I knew who it was, whose car. It was the exec of the base. And I yelled at him to halt. And that was futile. You know, it was cold and the windows were up. And he kept going, so I fired. And he took all the rubber off his tires, and he jumped out of the car and came charging back at me. And then about, I guess, almost to the fence, he suddenly realized I was just carrying out his orders. So he said, I was a seaman, second class, and report that you discharged your weapon in the line of duty. Yes, sir. So the Japanese didn't make it that night, but he did. It was exciting and a tense time there because there was a lot of pressure. Well, after that, I was transferred to Jacksonville. Before the war, the Navy had just Pensacola. That was where the training came. But during the war, they expanded it to Jacksonville and Corpus Christi. And I went to Jacksonville. They weren't ready for us. They didn't have planes. And I guess in January of 42, a whole month, we just had a heck of a time. We played golf, tennis, swam, dated, and rode horseback. I don't think the Japanese even knew we were there.
Now, what type of aircraft had you been training on?
Well, with the Navy, they were called it the Yellow Peril. Mm-hmm. It was a biplane. plane that the Navy manufactured themselves in their own, they had a plane. I think it was called an N2S, and it was yellow. It had very narrow landing gear, and it was very easy to drag a wingtip landing. And we all had money up that that we would or would not drag a wingtip. I came that close once, but I made it. Then when I went to Jacksonville, there was old Ranger planes. I broke my elbow when I was 5 years old, and the carrying angle of it is wrong. They took me in spite of it because they wanted pilots so bad. But every time I had a physical, the doctor said, "Well, how in the hell did you get in with that arm?" Well, there's a jerk down there in Jacksonville said, "Son, if the Japanese were attacking this base at this moment, would you jump in a plane and go after them?" And I said, "Well, Doctor, I don't believe any of these planes have any ammunition." "No, I don't think I would." And he just thought, but he passed me. And the arm did bother me, working the throttle, they would get hurt in the joint, but there was, you know, nothing serious. But every inspection I had, "How the hell did you get with that arm?" I didn't tell them because they were desperate. But we had all sorts of planes down there. And the first plane that I flew was a Stearman, which is a open cockpit biplane. And the last plane I flew in my life that I owned was a Stearman. A friend of mine, a cousin, Ted Levy, who retired as an admiral with 30,000 flight hours, who's someone I ought to talk to. He and I bought this thing up in near Pittsburgh. It took us 4 days to get home on account of weather and so forth. And our wives were not happy with us taking that much time. But we flew it for quite a while out there, and then he had a stroke, and he had to quit. And I got so deaf that I had to quit. So, but I started my career in the as a naval aviator with a Stearman. I ended up with a Stearman, which full cycle. But we had a whole bunch of different planes. They were, what do you call it, SNJ, which was a low-wing monoplane, advanced. I ended up in squadron flying P-boats, PBYs, which were flying boats, really. And they had a top speed of 105 knots. And the controls had no help. And it just took main force to get them up. And the plane was used during the war mainly as a rescue plane. It went out on strikes, and they went with us. And if a pilot was shot down, they'd go in and pick them up. It was, I didn't, the only time I got in trouble with that thing, they gave me check rides to advance you to the next. And this was a check ride to see, you know, if I was going to get my wings. So I was, you know, doing very well. And the instructor was sitting in the seat next to me, and he was reading the Reader's Digest. And if came in, if the water was still, if there's no wind, it was very hard to judge your height. If you bounced, you were supposed to wait till the plane slowed down and pull back on the yoke and then stall it in. Well, I bounced. Instead of waiting for it to slow down, I pulled back on the yoke, and that made the plane go up like this, and it was in danger of stalling out and going there. Well, this instructor boy, he forgot all about the Reader's Digest. He grabbed for the throttles and stuck the nose down, so well, I didn't pass that check. It was the only one I didn't pass, and I shouldn't have. But I did get through all right. And then I was sent to American Airlines, had a school out in Fort Worth where they were training Navy and Marine. Let me go back. Toward the end of the session training at Jacksonville, the upper 10% of the class was asked if they wanted to be Marines. Volunteer, and I wanted to fly medium bombers, so I said I want to. And my fiance was very unhappy that I decided to go in the Marines. She thought that was sudden death. But to clarify things, the Navy trained naval aviators, and some of them went in the Navy. And a very few of us went in the Marine Corps aviation. In my book, the top people were not necessarily the Marines. It was the guys that flew off of carriers, because that's the toughest line there is, and it still is, and particularly at night. And I flew off a carrier once. I never landed on one. I didn't go through what they call it was on land, simulated, and they had cables and so forth, and the guy there with the paddles. But anyway, I went through the school there at Fort Worth. Fort Worth was a very hospitable town. In the BOQ, if the phone would ring, there was just one phone, and whoever was around would pick it up, and there'd be a female voice on the other end, and you'd say, who you want to speak to? You, honey. I mean, how hospitable can you get? But it was great training with these American Airlines pilots who, you know, there wasn't anything they didn't know about those planes. And just before I got there, there had been a crash, and two men had been killed. And what had happened was they were always giving us simulated emergencies. And this guy on takeoff, the instructor, cut one engine. Procedure was that you were supposed to feather the propeller and make it straight so it wouldn't obstruct the airflow by hitting a button. Well, apparently the student hit the wrong button and both engines stopped and it spun in. Well, they changed it was not very encouraging to see this wreck line off the side of the runway, by the way. They changed that to simulating. You just point to the button you should push. I had a guy named Ross who was an instructor. And you could take the word bastard out of the dictionary and put in Ross. But I was glad I had him. I mean, I felt like that instruction was the top instruction I ever got in anything, including not only flying, but school and everything else I tried to do. Well, then we were sent for 2 or 3 months to fly with the airlines, and I was assigned to Penn Central, which is long gone. It flew out of Washington, and we flew cargo mainly down to Miami and so on. I had a guy named Jimmy God was my the captain. I flew with a heck of a guy, and he told a story. He was coming into Pittsburgh one night, and his plane was icing up, and the DC-3 wasn't pressurized, and the ice was on his windshield. He couldn't see ahead. He opened the window and stuck his head out, and he had his co-pilot calling off the airspeed so he wouldn't stall the plane out. Well, right at a critical moment, his earphones blew up. But it was just as he got under the cloud layer and he landed, boom. Well, this hostess, stewardess, I don't know what they called them in those days. It was her first flight, and she came up and she was white as your paper there. And she said, Mr. God, I was really afraid back then. And he said, don't worry, honey, so was I. And she said, I was praying to the Lord, and I think he's really the one brought us in. He said, well, that may be, honey, but next time I hope he uses his own earphones. So that was his story. Well, after that, I'd roomed in Fort Worth with a major, and we got out to San Diego at the same time, and he said, I'm going out to Guadalcanal with a transport squadron, and I'd like to have you with me, but you said you want to get in medium bombers, and they're forming a group up at Santa Barbara, and I can get you in that. And I said, well, Major, there's nobody I'd like to fly with more than you, but I appreciate that. Well, I got transferred up there. And I figured I'd have another 6 months in the States. So I called my fiance and told her that, and she said, well, what are we going to do? And I said, get married. So she said, yeah. Well, we got married. But
was she back here in Atlanta?
No, she was from New Orleans.
Oh, okay.
And she and Helen were good friends. And she told me more than once, if anything ever happens to me, Helen's your friend, your mate. So I have permission to. But we lived around the corner from each other, and the families all knew each other. We'd been married, what, 18 years?
Yeah.
And I'd been married 40 when my first wife was killed. So I've been married quite a bit. But I got up there, and we had a beautiful little college on Eucalyptus Hill, overlooking the Pacific, and you know, it was right out of House Beautiful. And the woman that owned it didn't want to rent it to me because she said, you know, you guys get your orders changed all the time. So not this time. And she had me pay an extra month. You'd be amazed at what we paid, $80 a month. So, we never got the planes. They sent them to some Marine pilots on the East Coast. And I got transferred then down to El Toro, which is near Laguna, South Laguna, and put into dive bombers. And this was a shock from being and twin engine planes with a father figure as the chief pilot, so suddenly being in this thing, there was a gunner in the back, but flying straight and level, so suddenly being trained to fly, to dive from about 10,000-11,000 feet at a 70-degree angle and drop bombs at 1,500 feet or less and then pull out. It took me a while to get used to it, but finally I got where I liked it. And I'll be modest, I was a damn good dive bomber pilot. There's not much call for us these days now. We were the original smart bombs, really. Our brains were the computers. And the one difference between a smart bomb and a pilot in those days is that a computer doesn't get scared. But other than that, it was very similar. The sight on this plane was just, well, originally they were like a telescope. And you go into the dive, and maybe at about 3,000 or 4,000 feet, you start looking through the tube, and crosshairs in the tube, and you had to accommodate for wind. There wasn't any computer. You had to adjust for the wind, which was could be very tricky, because it could, in a 10,000 feet dive, it could vary. And at one point it could be behind you and then come in from the side. You had to fly the plane to adjust for that. But the people got so absorbed, mesmerized, I guess, looking through this tube, that there were a lot of pilots that just flew into the ground for this thing. And it was sort of a shadow that hung over all of us, you know, that could happen to us. Well, later they changed to a reflector sight, which is what the fighters had, so that you weren't concentrating like that. And I don't believe anybody did that with the reflector sight. But it was still a matter of an art form to, this plane had flaps, dive flaps, that opened top and bottom. And the reason for that was to slow it down in the dive. I think it dove at about 250 knots. And it enables you to fly the plane. If you didn't have that, it would have been accelerating the whole time, and the pressures on the controls would have built up and built up. This way, you could handle the controls all the way down. And you drop the bomb, and as you pulled out, you close the flaps and started jinking, I guess we call it, trying to keep disconcert the gunners. We did not have any aerial opposition in the Marshall Islands. I was sent there, first I was sent to Hawaii, and we were based in a place called Ever, a Marine base, which was where the Marines were at Pearl Harbor. And our skipper was shaving that morning when a bullet came in smashed the mirror he was looking at, and the bullet came right over his head and into the mirror. But we got new planes there in Hawaii, and some of the most beautiful flying I ever did was, we were running the engines in at slow speeds, and we'd fly around the islands, all of them, at, you know, 200 or 300 feet up, in and out of coves and so forth. And then we went from there out to the Marshall Islands, and we went out in a carrier. It was a Jeep carrier, a small carrier.
And what year was this that you, or what was the time frame?
1944. I think.
Okay.
The squadron, I'll go back and talk about the squadron that I joined. It was VMSB 231. The V stands for heavy and air, M stands for Marines, SB for scout bombers. And it was the oldest squadron in the Marine Corps. It dated back to World War I. Our skipper, his name was Elmer Glidden, was in the Battle of Midway. And this plane was a deciding factor in the Battle of Midway. Not the Marines, they didn't have much luck with it, but the ones that flew off the carriers, and they intercepted the Japanese fleet and sank their three of their major carriers within 11 minutes. And 20 minutes or so later, they got the fourth one. And this plane was obsolescent when the war started. It cruised at about 150 knots. And the man that led that attack, his name was, I think, McCluskey. And he'd reached the end of his search from the, I think, the Lexington. But he decided to go on a few more minutes, and he spotted the wake of a Japanese destroyer. And he decided that destroyer must be headed back to the main body of the fleet, and he followed them. And they caught the Japanese changing armament. They had found that we had some carriers, and they were putting armor-piercing bombs on the planes. They were refueling. They had hoses all across the deck. They had two sets of ammunition, the one they were taking off and the one that they were putting on. And we caught them just at that point. Their air cover was down at water level. There's no coordination, but the torpedo bombers had come in, and they didn't make a hit. But what they had done was to bring down all of the Japanese fighters. One of the men that's, I think the only one that survived in the squadron was a man named Ensign Gay, who lived in Atlanta for years. He was a hell of a pilot, but politically he was to the right of Genghis Khan, I think. Which had nothing to do with what was going on in the Pacific. But Glidden, the pilot, head of the squadron, was shot down, a man named, I think, named Henderson. And the field at Guadalcanal was named for him, Henderson Field. And Glidden brought the squadron of the group back after dark to Midway. And then at Guadalcanal, he got another Navy Cross, and he was really loved by the squadron. Helen was so impressed at our reunion at the way the guys felt about him. And since he died, there's really been no interest in another reunion. I think part of that is his death, and also the fact we all getting old and having trouble getting around and so forth. But that squadron came back from Guadalcanal to El Toro, and that was where I joined it. And I lived at South Laguna, and we moved into a little house 80 feet over the water. You could see Catalina from there, and that was $50 a month, so things were different. The we went out, as I said, and I can't remember the month right now that we went out to Hawaii. And I was the operations officer, the flight officer. I assigned people to take different flights. Well, we got a call for the squadron to fly immediately from Everett to Ford Island to be loaded on the carrier to go down to the Marshalls. Well, all the guys were in the officers' club, and most of them drunk. And I picked out the ones I thought were the soberest. And they really had a happy time flying. Nobody, fortunately, everybody landed safely, and they loaded these planes on the carrier. The squadron was divided up. One group went out on a transport ahead of us. They were very disgruntled. One of the things that I think was bad was that the skipper, Glidden, and our executive officer, his name was Homer Cook, and I, the three top officers, all went on the carrier, and none went with the this advance base, and that it was a real bad split in the squadron. Homer Cook, by the way, was from Covington, Georgia. He graduated from Georgia Tech when he was 17. He was brilliant. Guy, an excellent pilot and a good leader. He was shot down on a nothing mission late in the war. And he and his gunner were killed. I have the squadron diary where it states that. I can go into that a little bit more. I had assigned a guy to take pictures, which was the most dangerous thing we did. There was no aerial opposition in the Marshalls, but the Japanese gunners really, they had a lot of practice. And after an attack, it was very poor strategy. The photo plane would come in all by itself and take pictures. And I had assigned this job to a guy that was, let's say, was not aggressive. And Homer was very, shook his head and he said, I'm getting that flight myself. And he jumped in his Jeep and raced down to the end of the runway and got this guy just before he took off. And Homer took the flight, and he was shot down on that flight. And, it had absolutely no impact on the outcome of the war. And just a real loss. But my wife used to be amused by the names of the three senior officers in the squadron, Elmer, C.O., Homer, and Cecil. She said those names must strike fear into the Japanese hearts. But we were out there, I think, about a year. I flew 60 missions, and my plane got hit more than once. In fact, I had four sets of wings on the thing, but I was lucky. We didn't have a very high loss, but there were some guys. There's people down in the Solomons referred to what we were doing. We were operating in the vacation islands. And compared with what they were up against, we were. When they went in the Guadalcanal, our fleet turned and ran. What was the guy, the took the carriers out of there. The Marines called him Haul Ass, whatever his name was. He was always low on fuel. On the other hand, we were down to two carriers, and I think he was, you know, within his rights to be sure that they didn't get lost. But in the early days of Guadalcanal, the Japanese heavy cruisers, and I think even battleships, came down what was called the slot, and they bombarded the Marine installations and the aircraft and so forth with 16-inch shells. And the guys that withstood that said those shells were much more frightening than the bombs. They didn't have enough to eat. I went out from San Diego to Pearl Harbor on board the Kitty Hawk, which we call the Kitty Maru. And the skipper of that thing, no, I wasn't there for that.
What we're going to do is I'm going to pause this and turn this tape over. Hold on. Okay.
It was the skipper, it was a United, what do you call it, fruit, you know, the banana boat that had been converted to transport. Okay. We went out from Hawaii out to Midway. On that, and he had been at Guadalcanal, and some overzealous guy had taken the targets that they used to navigate in the shallow waters that the Japanese had put up and painted them out. And this guy ran his ship aground, and to get it floating again, he threw off all the medical supplies that were for the Marines. Not only did the Marines not have medical supplies, but they were reduced to eating Japanese food, rice, that sort of stuff. So, yeah, we were in the vacation islands compared with that. But in that Michener's Tales of the South Pacific, he talks about one pilot, Buzz something, I think. And the chapter, I think, was called Milk Run, which was a term for the kind of flying we were doing, I guess. And he said, some guy got shot down, killed. And I said, well, it may have been a milk run, but it wasn't for that man that day. And that's the way I felt about it. The people at home thought you were in danger all the time. Actually, I guess over the time I was out there, I was under fire maybe 4 or 5 hours, really. Of course, there was always the possibility of operation next and that sort of thing. But I think that the tension for the people that left behind wasn't as great as it was on us. One big difference between us and the pilots that flew in Europe was that we were never in a civilized context, whereas those guys, they'd fly out over Germany and Austria, really get whipped up badly. They had terrible losses in the B-17s and the B-24s. But then they'd come back and into a civilized world. They'd go into London to pubs and they'd good food and women and so forth. And I think the contrast day after day of this normal living as compared with out there where they were about to get really mangled, made the level of mental problems much greater in the Atlantic or in Europe than it was in the Pacific. When I came back from overseas, and I'm jumping around here, I was in Montgomery on the way home, and I looked the picture of health, but all of a sudden I developed a very high fever and chills, and I checked into the Air Force, Air Corps, I guess, hospital there in Montgomery, and they never were able to diagnose what my problem was. I was there about 6 weeks, and they thought I wasn't going to make it. They let my wife come in and see me, which was against rules. But there was a, next to me was a ward with 8 Air Corps B-17 pilots who had just come back from Europe. And they were really noisy and excited. I mean, I could hear them through the walls. They began to calm down after a couple of weeks. And they went to see a movie. They were allowed to see a movie. And they had captured, they showed captured films of German fighters shooting down B-17s. And these guys came back and they were just wild. One guy cut his wrist. But I never, I visited the hospitals in Honolulu where a couple of guys I knew were there. And I never saw any similar mental problems that we had out there. I'm being an amateur psychiatrist, but as I say, I think it was the fact we were never in a civilized situation. And, of course, all of us felt we were, you know, we were young, we weren't going to get it. I was one of the older ones. I was 24. Our skipper was 26, 27. One of the youngest, or the youngest naval aviators, was former President George Bush. I don't know whether you've seen on the tube. Have you seen this? There's a book called Flyboys. It's written by a man. He was a naval corpsman who was assigned to the Marines, and his father was one of the flag raisers on Iwo Jima. And of course, Bush was shot down, and his two crewmen, one wasn't a regular crewman, one was an intelligence officer that wanted to go to see what it was all about, and they didn't survive. He bailed out, his plane was on fire, and as he was coming down, the plane exploded. But he said in this interview, you know, his not a day goes by, I don't think about that. He got picked up by an American submarine. The others who weren't so fortunate, the Japanese killed and ate their livers. But that was one thing that hung over us, was we didn't think if we were taken prisoners, we'd survive. But I'm not sure. Years later, 1982, my wife and I went back to the Marshall Islands, and it was a very discouraging thing. It had been a pristine island. We'd taken it without a fight. There were about 8 Japanese on there, and they just surrendered, in spite of all you hear about that. But it was a mess. The beaches were all littered with bathtubs and so on and so forth. And if there had been a flight out that night, I would have wanted to leave. beautiful island, and we went way down on, it's an atoll. An atoll is a remnants of a volcano where the peak has collapsed, and then the ridges that are left just underwater over a millennia have built up with the coral till it's come up out of the sea. And the string of islands, the atoll I was on, Majuro, was 20 miles long and about 10 miles wide. And at one point, a huge task force was anchored in there. But when we were back there, I met a Japanese soldier who was doing with his wife what I was doing, going back. And he had been on MILLE, which was M-I-L-L-E, which was one of the very heavily armored Japanese islands that we were hitting. And we exchanged letters, and I turned the letter over for your files there. But one question I asked him was, did you capture any American pilots, and did they survive? He said there were five, and no, they didn't survive. He didn't say we killed them, but this, that had to be what it was. He has a very interesting letter. I sent it to a couple of magazines, thought they might want to publish it, but nobody's taken me up on it. The I seem to be wandering around here.
That's okay. It's flowing fine.
Okay. You still with me?
Mm-hmm. I'm here.
Let me check to see if we need to get.
Tell us to turn on the. Coming back on the cruiser on the battleship with your dog.
We've got about 5 minutes left on this tape, and we can go to another one, but if there's something you want to fit in these last few minutes, then let's do that, and then we can pick up another.
Well, I've gone back to rest and recuperation, so it's called, in Hawaii, and the state of the Chris Holmes estate, which was where Roosevelt stayed when he went out there, and they went around and took all the coconuts off the trees, so none of them were hitting. They didn't care about us. I bought a Scottish Terrier while I was there. There were a good many Scots in Hawaii, and I named him Shorty McSnorter. A short snorter, the pilots that flew over the ocean had dollar bills, and they'd go in the bar to get a short snort, and everybody would sign the bill. Some of them, they'd take them together, were hundreds of feet long. Well, so since this Scotty had flown from Hawaii back to the Marshalls, I figured he'd qualify, and he drank beer, by the way, he loves beer, and out of the bottle. And I put the Mac on there because he was Scottish. But when I came home, I had the squadron carpenter make what looked like a toolbox for him. And I came back on a destroyer, the Grant, which had been the Battle of Surigao Straits and almost been sunk. And she lost 55 of her crew. And I got on board the destroyer. It couldn't stop. It couldn't anchor. It only had one engine that was circling around. And another Marine and I got on there. And I just left the dog in the box with my stuff. And I went in for noon chow. And the commanding officer of the destroyer, a man named Nicewiner, he looks at me, he says, "Captain Alexander, that dog of yours, yes, sir, he can stay for the cruise with our dog Lady on the, I've forgotten the designation, it was the tallest part of the ship. But you, sir, are going to have to clean up after both of them." So that, what he really got to liking my dog, and when I remember coming in under the Golden Gate, he and I were up on this bridge, and the dog, my dog who had lost his hair, was beginning to grow back, was shivering. And the captain took off his wind jacket and wrapped the dog up in it. And I got off at Mare Island with him in this box. And I was afraid he was going to be slapped in quarantine. We got on a bus, and I carried the dog in this box, and he started snuffling around and making noises. Everybody in the bus was looking at this box, and they all looked friendly. So I finally opened it, and Mike Snorter, you know, looked out, and everybody applauded. But he lived to be about 16. I brought him back to Atlanta. And Helen's daughter had a Scotty who died. My son had and couldn't take care of him. He was Shorty McSnorter the second, so he was, when I was up in Connecticut after the war, I was working in a New York office, and one night my wife and I had nothing better to do, and we rode to the VA from Sergeant Shorty McSnorter that he had grown up out where the indoors and the outdoors weren't defined. And he wasn't a housebroken, and he wanted to go get trained under the GI Bill. Well, we just mailed a letter. After a while, we got a letter back from the VA addressed to Shorty, saying they'd look through the codes and laws, and unfortunately the GI Bill applied only to Homo sapiens, not to canines. But a dog with your experience, I'm certain, can learn to stand on his own three legs. Hermie was down at this butcher where she had bought dog food, and she went in and said she wanted some dog food, and the butcher said, "Is that the dog that wants to go to school?" And she says, "How did you know?" He said, "Well, there's an article in the paper about it." Well, the Bridgeport Herald, which was pretty much a, yellow journal, they came out and took a picture of Hermie with an arm around the dog, and it was on the front page, and it said something about Max Snorter, alcoholic, rides the bridge. And all our hoity-toity friends up there, which were part of Helen's crowd when she was growing up, couldn't believe that she had allowed a picture to be put on the front page. They thought it was a fake, but it was real. He was a news hound.
Is there, let's say weird. Okay, we're right at this. We're gonna stop this tape and get another one, because